for our next speaker, it reminds me of a scene from this movie called as The Hobbit, where Martin Freeman is in front of this Smaug the Dragon, and then he says, all the folks and stories fall utterly short of your magnanimity, O Smaug. And I find myself in a similar position when trying to introduce Miles, who I think that sincerely does not need an introduction here. So, yep, thank you. Well, a round of applause for Miles.
Thanks very much, everybody. Well, thank you to start with to Michael for doing a fantastic introduction for me. I told him, he showed me the slides beforehand to kind of have a review before coming on, and I told him this is achievement unlocked. The person who's doing a talk about Shapeless immediately before me is going to be doing a better talk than I am on Shapeless. And this for an open source project that started off as not a joke, but not something that was entirely serious, or at least it was never intended to be something that would be used in the kinds of context that Michael is using. I mean, he's Comcast is slapped all over his slides. It's used in a really serious kind of low-level, high-performance application of this kind of stuff. And it's just absolutely awesome to see it being used. And I'm absolutely delighted that it's turning out to be not just something I play around with, but something that's actually useful and usable and all the rest of it. Anyway, so I'm going to be talking about something a little bit different, something that I've been working on for, I don't know, maybe the last 3 or 4 months. And it's kind of taking some of the stuff that Shapeless does with deriving type class instances, sort of lifting it a level. And the thing I've been looking at is, as the title suggests, is deriving type class instances for cats. So cats is the new principled type for functional programming library representing abstractions for principled functional programming in Scala. I'm not sure if CATS has a sensible acronym that could be unpacked or something like that. But anyway, it turned out that sort of immediately after kind of submitting the talk and the talk title, I realised that actually maybe so CATS deriving type classes for CATS. The library I've been working on is called Kittens. And so hence, this is the very literal talk title. But then I realised a little bit later that maybe a better title for the talk would have been "Type Classes for Cats," and that would have been a great idea. Unfortunately, there's a certain amount of. There was a certain amount of protest about that, so it really still is just to talk about my library kit. Sorry about that, folks. So this is also going to be a very sort of ad hoc kind of talk, because I actually find myself in the embarrassing situation that quite a lot of the stuff that I plan to demo this afternoon, I can't actually get to work, and the reason is that. The reason is that Kittens is based on a stack of very, very new and rapidly developing pieces of software. So it's based on CATS itself, which is changing very rapidly. CATS is a library which provides type classes of kind of this kind of general category, the instances that I'm going to be deriving ultimately are going to be I think I can pretty much cover the entire stack that for the ADTs, the algebraic data types that Michael kind of described very nicely in his talk. I'm reasonably confident that I'll be able to work out some reasonably principled mechanism for automatically deriving, not necessarily the best, not even necessarily the desirable, but at least some reasonably natural kind of instance for each of these type classes. Where I've got to so far, and the stuff I can actually show currently, are I can show Functor, I can show foldable, which isn't actually on this map. The stuff that it's been very, very, very interesting because a lot of the type class derivation I've been showing up until now has been off type classes indexed by types of kind star, so fully saturated, fully applied types. So a type class for a monomorphic case class, a type with no type parameters. All of the really interesting type classes that cats provide are type classes which are indexed by types of kind star arrow star. So things like functor itself, obviously you would have a functor instance not for list of string, but for list. You would have a foldable not for a tree of string, but for tree. So there's a whole load of the infrastructure in Shapeless has had to be generalized to allow it to be to provide derivations, generic representations of higher kinded types. And this is actually taken quite a lot of interesting work and reworking to kind of get this stuff to work smoothly. So Cats is the library it's based on. Cats is changing fairly rapidly. There's a whole bunch of other type classes which are not, if you like, first class citizens in the Cats library, and there's a good reason for that. One of the design decisions that's been taken in Cats is that every type class should come equipped with some laws. There should be properties that we can verify about a given type class, about its structure, and verify for instances of for any given type. So that kind of makes sense for all of the type classes you see here, and it kind of makes sense for anything that you could imagine yourself sitting down to write by hand. I mean, typically when you write a type class instance, there are some very specific set of capabilities associated with that type class that you're trying to capture, and those things you would expect to be lawful, to have particular kinds of regular properties. However, the key thing I think about the idea of type class derivation in general and kittens in particular is that we're trying to avoid having to write these things by hand. What we want to happen is for the Scala compiler, in conjunction with the framework that's provided by Shapeless, by Kittens, to be able to create instances out of as little as possible that we have provided ourselves. So typically, we will want to simply provide an ADT, a sealed family of case classes, and have as much work done as possibly can be by the compiler. So in this particular context, it turns out there's a whole bunch of other type classes which they just don't have laws because they're too simple. So one example of this would be, for example, the type class pure. So pure of t, for instance, is going to essentially give you a runtime value of some type t. So pure of int, for example, is going to give you some runtime integer value. So the question is, which integer is pure of int actually going to give you back? The answer is there's no particularly good answer. There are infinitely many. Well, all right, where we're talking about ints here, there is an extremely large finite number of possible answers to that question, and there is no way of pinning that down in a principal kind of way to any given instance. There used to be a pure type class at one point in Scala Z. It was called pointed there rather than pure. At one point there was a massive purge of so-called lawless type classes from Scala Z on precisely these grounds. And I think there was a very, very good reason given for it. I'm actually not going to talk about pure. I think zero or empty would be a better bet. So if we think about the classic monoid, We know we have the monoid. We have the two sort of standard monoids that everybody talks about for integers. We've got the additive monoid, which uses zero as its zero, as its unit, as its entity, and we have the multiplicative monoid for integers, which uses one. So, if you were to define a zero of int, how do you choose? Well, you can't. And the answer that the line was that was taken by Scala Z at the time and is continued by Katz is that because there are no principled ways that you can choose, we should just simply not do this at all. We should think about what are the type classes that that something like a zero or an empty would contribute to. Well, it contributes to monoid. Monoid provides if you have a monoid instance for integer, it will give you a unit value, which will give you back the corresponding the corresponding integer value. The key thing is, though, that there is a collection of laws which relate the characteristic append operation of the monoid with the unit value. So jointly, the monoid instance provides laws which cover both its monoid nature and also, if you like, its component, its subpart, which is effectively a zero, unit, empty, whatever you like to call it. Now that's fine if you're writing this stuff by hand, because you'd only ever write all of these things in one go. You would write append, you would write unit at the same time. There is no way that you would really think about separating these two independently not particularly well defined things into two separate pieces. If you could just join them together and define one thing all at once in a nice, well defined, lawful kind of way. So the response to people, and that includes me, sort of going to the Katz or previously the Scala said mainly saying, hey, I could really use a zero or an empty, has always been, no, you don't need it, just use the monoid. That does what you want, it's just fine. And that's right, that's correct, if it's you that's writing the monoid instance. If, on the other hand, it's the compiler that is writing the monoid instance, suppose that the constructors of your ADT are sufficient, and we'll see some examples of how this kind of works out in a moment, to if you like, read off a natural reading of append, but they're not going to give you an automatic definition or a sort of a natural interpretation of zero. In that kind of circumstance, what you really like to be able to do is say, okay, I have a data type, I'm going to specify that I have a particular kind of unit value, and I'm going to fix it. So for example, for a list like data type, I might specify that my empty for this list-like thing is the nil data constructor, and I might then hope that the append operation is going to be possible to have the compiler read off the structure of the data constructors. But to be able to do that, I actually need to have this zero empty type class instance available to provide my explicit manually constructed instance without being forced to write all the rest of it. So it turns out that for me to do the type class derivation stuff I want to do in Kittens, I have to rely on a whole stack of so-called lawless type class instances. These have all been hived off in Katz to another project, a related project called AliKatz. The possibilities of Katz-related memes for principled functional programming have been massively enhanced by Eric and his brilliant choice of Katz as the name of the underlying library. So AliKatz is also kind of a rapidly changing library. And it gets worse. So we've got sort of shifting sands underneath us here. It turns out that a lot of the stuff that Adrian was talking about in his talk before Michael's, despite my kind of carping and griping and general grumbling, I agree with huge amounts of it. I mean, the handling the implicit scope is enormously difficult, and it's even more enormously difficult where you're providing the instances of a of an implicit as a third party, if you like. So the normal way, I mean, it's actually this is I've kind of assumed that this is the normal way. I kind of gather that there are lots of people who don't really think this is the normal way of doing it. But the normal way of providing type class instances in an ideal world is to provide them within the implicit scope. So that means if you've got a type class f of t and you've got some type t, you would typically, in an ideal world, define the instances of f either in the companion object of f or in the companion object of t. And there are a whole bunch of really nice reasons sort of intrinsic to Scala as to why you want to do that. Primarily captured by, it's just very, very convenient to be able to rely on automatic search of those companion objects rather than having to depend on a whole bunch of imports. Unfortunately, if you are not the author of F and you're not the author of T, you don't get that option. And a type class derivation library like Kittens is just of its very nature supposed to be distinct and different from either the type classes that you're deriving for, and perhaps even more so independent of the types for which the type class instances are being derived. So Kittens is immediately in this awkward place of having to deal with how to inject type class instances into a scope which already includes type class instances which have been manually provided, and somehow or other arrange the priorities of these instances so that when you ask for an instance of f of string, that you get something which is appropriate rather than something which just happens by some kind of random fluke of import order or something like that, or some sort of scoping accident happens to be the thing that comes out on top in the sort of the calculus of implicit priorities, which, as Adrian alluded, is enormously fiddly and complicated. So in the process of trying to put this thing together, I went down another route, which was to try and put together a library which I think, I hope, will be a kind of very... where are we? Shift control. A library called Export Hook, which is essentially a way of providing a kind of a very lightweight opt-in mechanism for providers of type classes. This would be, say, cats itself or alleycats, would be able to provide a sort of a way of indicating to an unspecified, so this is a generic thing, there are no shapeless dependencies here. Anybody who wants to put together type class derivation infrastructure can make use of this library. It's very, very small, no dependencies, of any sort whatsoever, very, very lightweight. And it provides a way of annotating your implicit scope, so annotating your companion object or the stack of traits that you probably have underneath your companion object, saying, this is the point at which I would like to insert derived instances. So this was another thing that I kind of discovered that I really desperately needed to do to make this stuff work, to kind of juggle the derived type class instances against the existing ones. Okay, so this is also kind of rapidly developing and has gone through a number of iterations. One of the most recent ones is that so export hook itself is inevitably makes use of a macro. It uses the macro Paradise plugin to provide a macro annotation which allows you to kind of inject stuff into the definitions of the implicit scope via the companion object. Okay, it's a macro. Shapeless supports Scala 2.10 to 11 and Scala JS for 2.10 and 2.11, as does Cats, as does Alleycats, as does the whole current, pretty much all the current very, very active development in the sort of the general type level family of projects. There's a whole bunch of different ways that you might go about approaching managing a macro code base which is split between 2.10 and 2.11, and then most of them are actually really, really quite ugly. There's the approach that I've taken in Shapeless, which has been to have separate branches for 2.10 and 2.11, Other people make use of SBT's feature for managing Scala version-specific source subtrees within a single branch. And some people kind of write their own sort of ad hoc little kind of shims over the different macro APIs that are present in Scala 2.10 and 2.11. So in the process of actually doing the work in conjunction with Alistair Johnson, who frankly deserves a medal for the huge amounts of work he's done getting Scala.js support in almost every single interesting library anywhere. It's quite incredible how much work he's done in this kind of stuff. He has been pestering me quite reasonably for trying to produce single branch builds of all of my stuff and all of everybody's stuff, because it just does make this stuff so much easier. So under pressure from him, I went with that approach in Export Hook. And in the process of doing that, I realized there was probably rather a nice way that we could provide a very, very lightweight, simple mechanism for allowing you to write macro code to the Scala 2.11 API and have it still be compatible with Scala 2.10. And I was at ICFP a couple of weeks ago, and so I'd done this sort of, if you like, baked into Export Hook. And while I was at ICFP, it just kind of struck me, oh, I can pull this out into a separate, very lightweight project and then rework Export Hook in terms of that. And that ended up being this library, MacroCompat, which does just exactly that job. Amazingly, since it's only been in existence for about 2 weeks now, already has about half a dozen projects using it, which is kind of fun. Which suggests it's pretty clearly something which is meeting a very real need. Anyway, all four projects that Kittens is sitting on top of have been under extremely rapid development: Cats, Alley Cats, Export Hook, and MacroCompat. And I have been building Kittens don't do this at home, kids, because it will end in tears, on snapshot releases of all of them. And the net result is that I cannot currently build Kittens at all, because things have moved on, snapshots are stale or out of sync, and I have about a day's work, I think, probably rolling everything forward to current stable releases. So what I'm actually going to do instead of trying to demonstrate, I can show you some code, but what I can do a demo of is the stuff that I think ran out of time in the sort of the more general type class derivation talk I've been doing for most of this year. I don't know who's seen one of the type class derivation talks I've done this year, either in person or the videos. I think quite a few people. Well, I mean, basically, there was some stuff on deriving functor and foldable right at the end of that talk, and I think I might have just touched on it at Scala Days in San Francisco, but never in any significant amount of detail. So I think what I'm basically going to do, because the principles are exactly the same. I mean, Kittens is essentially taking those ideas and turning that into a kind of a robust thing against the current, or allegedly against the current state of Cats and Alley Cats, but it shows you in a somewhat simplified proof of concept form the way that these higher kinded type class derivations work for useful type classes, for functor and foldable, and will hopefully give you some kind of a hint that this stack, this tower of type classes might actually, all of them, in some way or another, be amenable to automatic derivation, albeit with help from hopefully small sprinkling of custom of specific instances of the lawless type classes to provide sort of, if you like, the initial axioms to kind of get the derivation going using the more general stuff. Okay, so before I carry on, any questions? Any questions occurring to anybody before I start showing some code? No, okay, cool. So let's head over to. Hang on, don't worry. We can fix that in two ways. So one thing we can do is we can do that, which will help. And we can also do that, which will hopefully help a great deal. Are we good? Right, cool. So now I want to have a look at this one, which is the same thing.
Miles to show his work would violate the prime directive, and For Miles to show his work would violate the prime directive, interfering with a lesser culture.
Nonsense. Well, okay. So I mean, so some of this stuff is done in GHC. So I mean, there are. It's, the interesting thing is that it's mostly baked into the. So there are. There are various kinds of type class derivations that you get out of the box. A lot of the stuff in Shapeless, the Shapeless generic stuff, is based on GHC generics, and you can do a lot of this kind of stuff with GHC generics. So I'm merely a conduit, I guess, for a lot of this stuff. And Lars is responsible for bringing a lot of this stuff over from that as well, with the original type class. It was part of the origin. Okay, is that still? Okay, so let's have a look at functors then. What do we got? So a functor, as we were very ably shown several times, I think today. I think how many talks didn't define a functor today? So I think pretty much all of them. A functor is basically capturing the idea of a type constructor which represents things which can be mapped over in some way or another. So this is roughly the functor type class from cats. And it's going to give us our map instance. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be deriving a functor instance for this ADT. So this is a tree. It's a polymorphic tree. It has a single type parameter. Actually, one of the things I guess I should say is that right now, the way that the generalization of Shapeless generic is going is it's gone from generic of kind star to now we have a generic one which represents kind star arrow star. You could reasonably ask, well, what happens about things with, you know, two type parameters or three or four? And the answer is sadly going to be something like generic two, three, and four, because we are, in the interests of simplifying the language and making everybody's life easier, we've decided, apparently, that kind polymorphism is not the right kind of thing to have in the language, which is a real shame, because I think it would actually simplify things dramatically. It certainly would for me, anyway. Okay, so this is a polymorphic tree type. I mean, it's a trivial tree. We have a seal trait, and we have a leaf, which contains a value of type T, and we have a node. So this is just a simple binary tree type. So a node which has a left and a right. So intuitively, if you just kind of look at this thing, it's kind of, I mean, if you just sit down and write our functor instance for this type, let's have a look up here again. I mean, I assume pretty much everybody in the room can see immediately what you have to do to write this type. What you would do is that you would have an argument of type T. You would pattern match on it. You give you your two branches, if you like, of your sum type, your leaf branch and your node branch. You've got a function from A to B or whatever. You're going to apply it in the case of of a leaf to the t value that you have that you've revealed by pattern matching, and in the node case, well, we're just going to recursively map over the left and the right and give ourselves back a tree of started from tree of A, tree of T, and we're going to get back a tree of B. Trivial to write, so trivial that why can't the compiler write it for us? You might think, and it can, if we have the right kind of generic representation available to do it. So here's how it goes. And for people who've seen the way that I've gone about doing typeclass derivation, I mean, it's very, very similar to the stuff that Michael showed you. This is kind of under the hood, I suppose, to some extent, of what Michael showed you for deriving codecs for Skovec. But it's exactly the same mechanism as is used in any number of other serialization, deserialization libraries that have popped up using Shapeless. One of the latest, and I think most interesting ones, is a new JSON library by Travis Brown, which called Circe, which bakes Shapeless-based type class derivation in at the outset, which given the traumas I was mentioning about injecting third-party type class instances into the implicit scope of third-party things, from my point of view, it's a great advantage to have a library actively supporting that, because it does make life a lot easier. That's done via export hook, actually, by the way. So it's the same general idea. So what we're going to be doing, though, is that we have to think about, well, what does it mean to decompose a polymorphic type into the kind of representation types that Michael showed us? Because we can't just unpack a leaf node, a leaf of T here, into an H list. I mean, if this was a monomorphic tree, if instead of T this was int, then the generic representation of a leaf of int, an integer leaf, would just be the H list int cons H nil. That's easy. What do you get if in fact T is a type variable? Well, you end up having to lift the H list type into a polymorphic context. So in a sense, what you have to do is construct I'll just type in here. We have to go from something which might have looked like type wrapper leaf equals int cons h nil, which is a fairly sane and sensible looking type, and we might have to go instead to leaf of leaf p for poly, I guess, t equals t cons h nil. So instead of deconstructing our tree type into fully applied saturated types, we have to deconstruct it into a collection of essentially type functions, which is what these polymorphic higher-kinded type alias is doing duty for us here. And it turns out that this is actually quite fiddly to do. People who've worked with libraries that make heavy use of higher-kinded types know that you just have endless difficulties with type inference, with unification, that's enough to be going on with. Basically, it means that essentially you end up in an awful lot of situations where you and I and the rest of the world can see things that the Scala compiler refuses to see in terms of inferring types, and the net result of that is that you have very little option, typically, but to manually construct the infamous type lambdas, and in the nightmare scenario provide a whole bunch of horribly ugly manual type annotations, the ugliest kind of type annotations. I can see Daniel nodding his head and weeping silently. I ended up having to do quite a lot of work trying to work out how we could avoid having to do this. Let's back up a bit. So we've got this tree type, and we know that we're going to have to somehow or other decompose it into a whole bunch of type functions of some sort or another. And we're going to be using those things to index our type class with. So it's the same kind of principle, but kind of lifted to the next level up. Whereas previously we might have defined sort of primitive type class instances for sort of atomic types, for things like int and string and such like, here what we're going to be doing is defining type class instances for, if you like, primitive type functions. So we're going to have a default functor instance here for ID. So ID, I'll just for completeness, I'm sure everybody knows what it is. Is the identity type function that looks like that. So that's, if you like, well, that's our atom. And this is the kind of thing that we are going to have to write by hand, because the compiler isn't going to be able, we're not going to be able to infer this. This is the kind of basic bits that the Typeclass Derivation is fracturing our more interesting type into. So implementation is trivial. So functor for ID with a function from A to B just applies the function. That's it, we're done. Okay, so what do we get if we are trying to derive the type class instance for that type function I showed for leaf, which is a function from some type t to t cons h nil? Well, I tried a whole bunch of different approaches to this, which involved basically doing it the same kind of way that I'd done the type class derivations for types of kind star, and ran slap bang into all of the inference and unification problems that I had. It was possible to sort of pick apart the higher kinded types, but it was never possible to actually get them bound to a type variable that you could then feed back into another bit of implicit resolution to continue the process of constructing the derived values. So in the end, I was wrecking my brains over this, and I at one point I really thought it was just not going to be possible to make this work. And then I hit on something rather nice, which is that the problem that I was having was somehow or other during an implicit resolution, I was trying to compute an output type in sort of the form that Adrian was showing as the sort of the kind of terrible thing that we should never ever do, and have that bound to a type variable to be fed into another implicit resolution subsequently. And the blocker was, it was impossible to get that type variable to bind, because the higher order type would not bind to a type variable. Just Scala C will not do it. It's the infamous SI2712, which some of us know by heart. implement higher order unification. It's kind of like the killer amendment. It's because it's kind of demanding so much that no one will ever go anywhere near it, when there is actually a bunch of possible, I think, answers which are more modest. But anyway, I digress. So given that that's not, that 2712 has not been fixed, okay, so we can't take anything out. Can we push something in instead? So I hit on this idea, essentially, of, and I'm just going to say it, I think I know what the reaction is going to be. The solution is actually to essentially do a continuation passing style conversion on the problem at the type level. We're going to do continuation passing style at the type level. What? I think Daniel is having some kind of spasm. Okay, so here's how it goes. Here's how it goes. So what we're going to be doing is, so this is for leaf, right? I'll start here, actually. I'll start with generic. So we're starting with our type leaf. So F is our leaf of T. We're going to compute a generic 1. So this is the lifted thing. So generic 1 applied to F. Generic 1 can introspect on the type. So it can see the type constructor. It can see the structure of the case class. It can see that it needs to construct a type function T arrow T cons H nil. It can do that. We know we can't get it out. But what we can do is we can push functor in. So what this generic 1 is going to do is it's going to compute the generic representation type of leaf, and then it's going to resolve an instance of functor for the representation type itself. So we're not going to take anything out. We push the continuation, the type level continuation, in and continue that one. Okay, you've got
it,
Daniel.
Really impressive.
Well,
that's really impressive.
It's actually surprisingly simple,
yeah.
And it works really well.
Yeah.
And to some extent, it actually fixes it's a workaround. It's a workaround for 2712. I mean, because you can't unify these higher kinded things, so just don't even try. Don't even try.
can you say it again for the people who didn't clap?
This is brilliant, Miles.
So what you might try and do instead. So what you might try and do instead, if you were doing this the way I used to do it, you might want to say that I'm going to be computing a generic, and this would be a .aux
Is there a Scala version of this code?
Sorry?
Is there a Scala version of this code?
Very funny. So you try and compute this type G here, and you'd want to bind that to a G there, and then you'd want to get the F of G, which is going to be a functor. Whoops, bam. Functor of G. So functor of G. So this is the way you derive type classes for types of kind star, and it crucially depends on the fact that the process of resolving generic for at F is going to result in type G being computed and bound to this type variable, which can then feed into functor. Let me get this right. Can then be fed into this type constructor here, and then implicit resolution can continue and carry on. But this doesn't work. Maybe I should have shown you this line first. So this doesn't work because if where G is a higher kind of type parameter, it will never bind to this type variable. So we just blocked at this point. So if you can't get the type out, what you can do is you can push the continuation back in, and that's what I'm doing here. So within the body of the generic one macro that's producing the sort of the from and to and defining the representation type, exactly as Michael showed you for types of kind star, it's also just wrapping that horrible, actually now compiler constructed type lambda. So we don't have to do it. I've done it for you in this horrible macro. How long do I have?
Don't stop in the middle.
Minus 10 minutes.
Oh, you're kidding me. No?
Finish your thought. Yeah.
How long do I really have?
We're done with the time.
Minus 10 minutes.
Oh, you're kidding.
It was all worth it.
Okay. All right, I'll keep going until people run away. Okay. So right, where are we? Right. Okay. So instead of trying to pull the type out, which isn't going to work, we push the continuation in, and that's the functor. So what we're going to get out of that, if we look at here, so this is gen. Gen now defines both from and to, but now also gives us another member value, which is the functor is computed for the representation type it's computed. So we're now going to take our f of a. We're going to map it. So this is two. This is going to take us into our generic representation. We now have functor for the generic representation, so we can map over the generic representation. So we've taken, say, our leaf of string, say, onto a leaf of integers, we've taken our hlist, which is a string cons hnil, onto an hlist, which is an int cons hnil. We use the other direction of the generic to map that hlist back into now a leaf of int. So that's what's going on there. So it's actually not adding a huge amount of additional complexity to what's going on. In some ways, it's actually simplifying things a little bit, as we'll see in the hcons case. Because now let's have a look at so previously what I would have done is I would have used sort of inference and unification to kind of split a representation type sort of head cons tail into a head and a tail. I resolved an instance of the head and an instance of the tail. Again, because these are higher kind of types, none of these things, the tail in particular, is it's a horrible, gnarly, potentially complicated type lambda that's been computed by the macro. That's never ever going to unify with anything over here. So instead, we just push the continuation through. Now what this is going to do now, this is hcons. So it's so we're saying that this there will be an instance of hcons 1 in any case where the representation type is an hcon. So it can be split in two. That means we've got two sides, and we can just push the functor down both. And then if we've got functor for each side, then it's kind of trivial to basically combine these things. There's a bunch of mechanics about sort of unpacking and repacking these things, but they're not essential here. What's essential is that we've been able to use this operator to decompose a higher kind of product type and chase the type class that we're trying to derive the instance for through on both sides of it, and then reconstruct that, map back into the original type to get us something useful. And this also works for the coproducts as well. So again, our coproduct, if we look back here at our tree type, so a tree is going to, well, this is going to unpack, we'll pattern match on this again, and we'll have a branch for leaves and nodes. But of course, you know, when we unpack a polymorphic tree, we'll end up with a polymorphic leaf and a polymorphic node. So again, we would be trying to unify higher kinded types. Isn't going to work. So we do the same thing with for the coproduct side. So we now have this secons thing. This is it a composite coproduct? And again, we just chase the functor through on both sides, and we just recombine. And here we've got something which is let's break that line somewhere.
Miles.
Yes.
Is it possible to use this with dependent method types to implement a general purpose workaround for lack of higher order unification?
I have some ideas on working around higher order unification. It is related. I've actually got something called split, which basically will unpack an f of g into an inner and an outer and chase a type class right. Derivation through both of them. And that kind of is pretty close to an implement. I've got some of the heuristics I use for kind of splitting these things apart. Bear in mind, F and G could themselves be complex types constructed via.
That's the whole point.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's the whole
exactly
point.
For sure. And I've got something in the split operator which kind of implements the sort of the Haskell greedy solution to this thing. And I'm sort of half thinking of it as a sort of a proof of concept that we could actually retrofit this as a fix for the more modest interpretation of what SI2712 actually represents and do that. I think that's feasible. I think it's something we can do in the type level Scala compiler.
Outstanding.
Yes. Okay. So there is more. And the more is, so one thing you could notice here is that previously in the derivations of Stein of kind star, I've ended up with two methods for each of product and coproduct. I had a base case for H nil, a base case for C nil, and then an induction step for H cons and an induction step for C cons. Now these collapse in this case because we've got this one operator. Which is able to manage to sort of, it goes down both sides, so it handles both cases. So we've collapsed 2 to 1 here, but it's also interesting to note that actually structurally, god damn it, products and co-products are looking really, really similar. Is it possible that we can actually unify these two things? And the answer is yes. With the magic of category theory, it turns out that there is a unifying abstraction between products and products where you're literally just flipping the arrows. I mean, that's all that we're doing. Where you can literally just flip the arrows have exactly the same structure of the code in the terminology of Michael introduced lax monoidal functors. I'm gonna raise you symmetric monoidal categories. In the language of symmetric monoidal categories, both products and co-products are different kinds of product in this more general sense. And it works beautifully. Also, for Julian's point of interest, it's very, very closely related to the underlying mathematics behind Ed's lenses stuff. It's very, very closely related. It turns out that a profunctor, for example, can represent a symmetric monoidal category. So there are some very, very interesting, very close connections with that stuff. So I can imagine a lot of this stuff just sort of, it's sort of collapsing, and I don't know quite what happens when we hit the singularity at some point. But anyway, this is very much the direction I want to go in Shapeless 3, which hopefully will not be too far away. So that's the general idea. I'm just going to do a quick demo to prove that this does actually work. So here's our tree. Here's a value. So let's head over to this REPL. I'm actually going to fail and restart. So if I import functor underscore, right, here's the tree I prepared earlier. That's this tree. And I've provided just, you know, the standard kind of boilerplate-y syntax for map here. So anything which has a functor instance will have a map operation defined on it. So this is just plain case class. It's completely independent of any of this stuff. It's just plain vanilla polymorphic case class ADT. So this is our tree, and I can do tree dot map. So the tree of strings. So underscore dot length. And there we go. And this works for any ADT which has a generic representation. Absolutely anything. So anything you care to mention now has a functor for free. And it's not a coordinator. This is actually a functor,
a real functor,
which actually represents, if you like, natural structural characteristics of the underlying data type. Okay, I'm done, I think.